Hey everybody, welcome to church. I'm so glad that you're here. You could even say that I am stoked to see you where you're at right now in your kitchen. Maybe you're sitting with the family together in the lounge. We're so glad that you're joining us for church today. So we're broadcasting onto all sorts of different platforms. We're like YouTube, Facebook, and our church online platform. We want to encourage you that if you're watching this on a computer right now, why don't you join us at church online, where you can find just great interaction. You can find some how you can get some good next steps to grow in your faith walk with Jesus, and where you can get individualized prayer. And so you can find that address by just simply going to our website, viewchurchsunningdale.co.za, and it's super easy to direct you from there. Hey, and why don't you just invite somebody? We're about to get going, but you still got time to invite someone to join you at church, and we're so glad that you would do that. But welcome. If this is your very first time, it's such an honor to have you here. And what we ask you to do is to connect with us. Connect with us via the online connection card or in the comment section, or the connect button might pop up. That'll just take you to the online connection card, where you can just give us some basic details of how we can contact you, just so that we can welcome you and see if there's any way that we can help you to take your next step, or maybe answer any questions that you might have. Throughout this church experience, you are most welcome to use the live prayer feature. That'll connect you to one of our hosts in a private chat window that will be able to pray with you and to stand with you with all that you're going through. And right now, we're going to get ready to worship God. So come on, huddle around the TV, huddle around the screen, turn the volume really loud, and let's engage with God as we worship together today.
When fear is coming, still you're calling me. When faith is lost and my hope exhausted, you will be my strength. When my mind says I'm not good enough, God, you're enough for me. I've decided I'm not giving up, 'cause you won't give up. You won't give up on me. Your love is holding on and it won't let go. I feel it breaking up like an echo. Your love is holding on and it won't let go. I feel it breaking up like an echo. Echo in my soul.
Your love is holding on and it won't let go. I feel it breaking out.
Amen. Isn't it so great that we get to worship God with our team all together? And of course, under these level 4 restrictions, we do have broadcasting rights where we can gather together and record this. And so we're glad and we're so privileged to be able to do this. We give God a serious praise for that. And I want to share some other praise reports with you before we get into more worship. How's this for a praise report? My 88-year-old mom has fully recovered from COVID. Praise Jesus. Amen. What good news in this time. This is another one. This is how good God is that this person's medical aide was rejecting their chemo treatment and they needed to upgrade to a higher plan and they didn't know how to go about this, but God has made a way and they're able to get the treatment that they need. Come on, God is on the throne. He is not taken by surprise. He is bigger than our biggest situations, bigger than our circumstances, because He that is in us is greater than He that is in the world. And so there is so much to be grateful for. I encourage you in this moment, just what can you be grateful to God for? And why don't you share that with us using the online connection card and submit a praise report? We've also got some things that we want to pray into as a church. So the reason why we give praise first is because we put our problems into their right perspective so that we can know that God is able and He's willing to move on our behalf. And some of the prayer requests that we've been getting is just continuous prayer for healing for my husband from brain cancer. Absolutely. Pray for my mom who's been struggling a lot during this lockdown, suffering with anxiety and not able to sleep. Pray for healing and protection and strength. For businesses, pray for a cousin that's living in the UK to commit their life to Jesus. Pray for provision for small and medium businesses and businesses of all sizes. So there are loads of prayer requests that we want to pray into right now. I'm not able to read them all out, but we're certainly going to stand together by faith. And what I love about every time someone submits a prayer request is that we have a team of people praying into those things. And so you can submit your prayer request with confidence on the online connection card, knowing that we're going to be praying together. So shall we just pray together? And then we're going to go into a moment where we're going to worship God with our giving. So Father, we thank You. We thank You so much, God, that You are a God who answers prayer. Lord, we thank You that every prayer is precious to You. And so right now, we submit every single one of these prayer requests before You. We thank You, God, that You've heard us. We thank You, God, that the prayer of a righteous person achieves much. And so, Lord, we just want to declare that You are our provider, our healer, our sustainer. And God, I pray that You would heal the sick. I pray that You would provide for those businesses and people in their job situations, and pray for those people to be healed of their sicknesses. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. Amen. I just love the fact that we get to pray together. And right now is an opportunity for us to worship God. So we're going to worship God in a song. But before that, we also want to worship God with our giving. I always say that we don't give to a church. We give to God through a church. And we believe in the principle of giving our first portion to the Lord. Because He is our provider. He gives us everything that we need. And so right now, we get to say thank You, God, for all that He's given us. He's given us health, family, friends, so much in this life, and we want to honor Him with that. And so right now, I'm going to pray for our giving to give you an opportunity to prepare yourself. The way that you can give online is you can go to our website and you can hit the give link there. Otherwise, hit the give button that's appearing in your comment section in the Church Online platform right now. So we're going to pray together, and you can take time to do that. Father, we thank You. We thank You that You provide for us. We thank You that You give us all that we need and more. God, we thank You for Your kindness and generosity in this season. And thank You, Lord, for those who have given over and above their regular tithes and offerings to give towards COVID relief. And we've seen so many people helped in that way, God. We want to honor You and worship You right now. And Father, as we worship You with our song, we're now singing, Lord, may we lift Your name up high. And as You were lifted up, Lord, I pray that peace would enter into our hearts in a moment of worship. In Jesus' powerful name, amen.
Lord, bless You and keep. His face shine upon you, be gracious to you. Lord, turn His face toward you and give you peace. Lord, bless you and keep you. Make His face shine upon you, be gracious to you. Lord, turn His face toward you and give you peace. Amen. 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 Lord, bless you and keep you. Make His face shine upon you and be gracious to you. Lord, turn His face toward you and give you peace. Amen. 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 We sing to you, amen.
Amen.
Let it be so. May His favor be upon you and a thousand generations, and your family and your children and their children and their children. May His favor be upon you and a thousand generations, and your family and your children and their children and their children. May His favor be upon you and a thousand generations, and your family and your children and their children and their children. May His favor be upon you and a thousand generations, and your family and your children and their children. May His presence go before you and behind you and beside you, all around you and within you. He is with you, He is with you in the morning, in the evening, in your coming and your going, rejoicing. He is for you.
He is for you.
He is for you. He is for you. He is for you. He is for you. He is for you. He is for you. Amen.
favor be upon you and a thousand generations and your family. May his favor be upon you and a thousand generations and your family and your children and their children and their children. May his favor and a thousand generations and your family and your children. May his presence, may his presence go before you. All around you and within you, he is with you, he is with you in the morning, in the evening, in your coming and your going, in your weeping and rejoicing. He is for you, 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 he is for you.
Father God, we thank you so much that you could be here today. We thank you, Lord, that no matter the circumstance, the obstacle, or whatever stands in our way, nothing will stop the Church of Jesus Christ moving forward. We thank you for everybody that could join us online today. God, I pray that you be with us. Every word that we hear, let it not just be something we hear, but let it be something that we receive. And we pray that we can become more like you after today's service. We pray this in your awesome name alone. Amen and amen. Hey, hello, and welcome to Church Online. My name is Phil, and I have the great honor and privilege of hosting you this morning as we start a brand new series, The Joy I Wish I Had, based on the book of Philippians. I'm super excited to get going today. I'm super excited to be in all of your beautiful homes, wherever you're watching from, if you've just tuned in, if you're in the kitchen, the bedroom, you're making breakfast, making coffee. Hey, so good to see you. Let us know in the comments what you're up to. And we're very pumped and very excited for what God has in store for today. Before we get started, how awesome has it been just during lockdown to be able to exercise in the morning? I know for me and my wife, Jean-Marie, we've been able to, most mornings, I'd be lying if I said it was every morning, but most mornings, I've been able to go out and go for a walk. I've even met up with a couple of mates and we've been walking on the beachfront promenade, and there's a lot of people. I don't want to beat around the bush. There's a lot of people. It feels like everybody's got a dog. But for a social person, kind of like myself, and there's some of you out there that are probably the same, really good to see human beings that we don't see every day in our house. Human beings doing human being things. The only awkward thing really has been whether we can interact and talk with people. I mean, there's been a couple of people, I don't know if you guys have this, but there's been a couple of people that I've recognized, but because of like the mask, you actually don't know whether they want to talk to you or not. And sometimes you're just deceived by the eyes, because you can have happy eyes or like don't talk to me eyes. And for me, I'm just like so quick to approach and to say, hello, how's it going? And some people are like, don't talk to me. And like they take like the wide route around me. Ego took a hit first couple of days, but hey, I'm starting to get it now. The worst is when you think you recognize somebody and hey, it's actually no one you've ever met before and you're waving like a crazy person. But hey, we're getting there. We're figuring it out. If you see me on beachfront promenade and you want to say how's it, please come and say how's it, but don't touch me because we don't do that. Anyway, we're so excited for this morning and to get going, and really in a series that we think is timely. We think it's the right time to be speaking about joy. And this whole series is based on the book of Philippians. And from the series, we can really draw out so many powerful biblical truths about joy. The truth is we can think about joy in a very worldly way, can't we? We can put joy on a person. We can put joy in an activity. We can put joy in an object. But how many of you know that those things often go away longer than what they stay? And our joy seems to be so momentary. One day we're joyful, one day we're happy, and the next it's gone because things change. Circumstances change, people change. I think this lockdown has come in and taken away a lot of joy from people. There's been things that we would associate our joy with and our happiness with, and because of the lockdown, things have had to change. For me personally, I love live sport, and to be able to watch sport has been a big source of joy for me. Listen, it can be anything. It can be horse riding. It can be football. It can be whatever. If it's live sport, I'm watching it and it's filling my tank. But at the moment, that's just not a possibility. And I've had to readjust. I've had to relook at things. But the truth is, we as the church and we as Bible-believing Christians, we don't think that joy is something that comes and goes. We believe joy is something that is consistent. We believe joy is something that can stay with you no matter what your circumstances look like. We believe it's an attitude. We believe it's a choice. And today we want to speak about it. And we're going to be going through the book of Philippians over the next few weeks. And today we're going to look at specifically the book, the first chapter in the book of Philippians, where we'll be speaking about, if you're taking notes today, we'll be speaking about the joy in suffering. And this can almost sound like a bit of an oxymoron to some. You know, how can there be joy in suffering? But we're going to find it out today, and we're going to learn principles from Paul on how we can do this. Before we get started, I'd love to speak about briefly what we understand about joy and really what we see joy in the Bible is all about. The thing is, joy has been a theme, a central theme in the Bible from the very beginning. If you were going to open up your Bible on the very first page, the book of Genesis, you'll see that God created and he said that his creation was good. And we take joy in nature. I don't know if there's any nature lovers out there, but sometimes just being out in nature, just being out by Table Mountain, or just being in one of the beautiful vineyards that Cape Town has to offer, it can bring you joy. And we see a scripture in Psalm 65, verses 11 to 12. I'll just read verse 12. It says, "The grasslands of the wilderness become a lush pasture, and the hillsides blossom with joy." We find joy in nature. The Bible also talks about finding joy in children. All of the parents out there, I'm sure you find a lot of joy in your children, especially when you're homeschooling maths and English and Afrikaans and things that you don't even know much about. I'm sure you're finding a lot of joy in that. The Bible says we find joy in weddings and being a part of weddings. The Bible says we find joy in even perfume. I'm not making this stuff up. The Bible talks about there are many things that we can find joy in. Everybody that's using, all the males out there using Aramis or Calvin Klein, shout out to you. We find joy in that. However, the truth is, we know that when we go through the Bible, that joy isn't a constant theme for mankind. It's not all just one massive joy fest. Sometimes in the Bible and even in our current lives, we can go through moments and seasons where it feels like we experience everything but joy. It feels like everywhere we look, there's a new obstacle to overcome. There's a new circumstance to move through. There's something that is taking and stealing joy from us. But this is where the Bible actually provides a unique perspective and teaching on joy. I'm going to tell you what it is. Joy is an attitude that God's people adopt, not based on a happy circumstance, but based on a decision to honor God and to thank him for our future victory, for his future promises that are going to come to pass in our life. And we see this actually prevalent with the Israelite people. A lot of us know the story of Moses, who led the Israelite people out of Egypt into the wilderness. The sad part about that whole story is that the Israelite people spent 40 years in the wilderness before they reached the promised land. But we read a scripture that says the Israelite people rejoiced in the wilderness. They were joyful in what looked like a moment where there was nothing to be joyful about. There wasn't food to come by. There wasn't water to come by. But it says in the scripture, Psalm 105, verses 43, that he brought out his people with rejoicing, his chosen ones with shouts of joy. Joy in the wilderness. What a crazy thought. Today, we want to look at the book of Philippians chapter 1, and we want to see what that means. Today, we're going to be speaking about and reading about Paul, who spent a lot of his life and spent a lot of his time writing scripture, books of the New Testament, from inside a prison cell. But Paul had an ability to be joyful in a moment where nothing about his situation, nothing about his circumstance dictated that he should be joyful. We're going to unpack what that means. And even before Paul, This is something that Jesus taught to his disciples, that your circumstance does not dictate your joy. It's your faith in Jesus, your faith in a Savior, that his promises will come to pass in your life, that what you're facing right now, there's a reason for it. There's a purpose for it. We don't believe any suffering. We don't believe any obstacles in this world is here for no reason at all. God is doing something. He's producing something inside of you that is going to make you a bigger, more complete, more whole Christian. That is our belief. But we want to teach over the next 4 weeks that we can have joy in the middle of it. We can be happy people. We can be content people. The lockdown, the coronavirus pandemic does not have to rob us of our joy. It might change the way that we live. It might change the way that we think. It might change the way that we parent, but it does not have to change the way that we have our outlook on life with joy, with happiness, and with contentment. Before we get going, I'd love to just give a bit of context to the book of Philippians that we're going to be reading through over the next 4 weeks. The Roman colony of Philippi was found in Macedonia, and they had heard the good news about Jesus on Paul's second missionary journey. This journey would be no ways considered a huge success on Paul's part. He faced opposition as soon as he started preaching the gospel. And even then, they threw him into prison, and not long after that, they took him out and they said, "You've got to leave this town." But even in that brief time, Paul was able to develop a small group of believers who believed in Jesus and trusted in God. And from there, his ministry would go on and reproduce. Where the book of Philippians picks up and where we see this letter is that Paul actually found himself in prison again. And a man by the name of Epaphroditus, crazy name. If you're looking for a son's name, Epaphroditus is yours. If you church Sunday in the Bible don't claim it, you can call your son that. A guy by the name of Epaphroditus went looking for Paul and found him in prison, and he gave him this gift. And Paul said, "Hey, I've got a letter for the people of Philippi. I've got a letter for the Philippians." And the whole meaning and crux of this letter was to encourage the Philippians that even though they were being persecuted, even though the believers there were finding so much opposition, so many obstacles to preaching and to spreading the good news, he wanted to say, "Hey, you take joy in your persecution. You stay joyful, and this is how." So before we get started today, I'd love for us to pray and really trust God for what he has got in store for us today. So let's bow our heads. Father God, we thank you for your word. We thank you, Lord, that joy is ours to have. That even though our circumstances might look different, even though there are obstacles, even though there are things we need to overcome, it does not mean we have to live like people without joy. We can live content, we can live happy, because we have got the truth of God's word in us and we've got his promises before us. I pray you be with us today and bless this word. We pray this in your name alone. Amen. Amen. Hey, if you're taking notes today, I've got 3 points that I want to draw from the book of Philippians chapter 1 that I think is going to help you. The whole title of today's sermon is Joy in Suffering. And like I said earlier, it can almost sound like a bit of an oxymoron. It can sound, you know, that doesn't make sense. And for the most part, it doesn't, especially when we're experiencing it. That's why it's so good to learn from a guy like Paul, to learn from the book of Philippians. What are some practical things that we can bring into our life? What are some great things that we need to understand that can help us live a life that's joyful? If you're taking notes today, my first point is this: joy in suffering requires perspective. And the scripture that we're going to be reading here is Philippians 1, verse 12 to 14. It says, "Now I want you to know, brothers and sisters, that what has happened to me has actually served to advance the gospel. As a result, it has become clear throughout the whole palace guard and everyone else that I am in chains for Christ. And because of my chains, most of my brothers and sisters have become confident in the Lord and dare all the more to proclaim the gospel without fear." This is a powerful, powerful scripture. And where we pick ourselves up here, this is Paul writing from a prison cell. So what he's referencing here when he says, "What has happened to me," he's talking about being thrown into prison. But then it goes into a completely different direction. I mean, if it was me writing from a prison cell that I'd find myself in, I would be busy blaming people. I would be busy moaning. I would be busy trying to find reasons to doubt God and to doubt what he's doing in my life. But Paul takes a whole nother route. Paul goes on to say that he is joyful. He is glad that the gospel continues to be preached and continues to go out. The people that Paul would have been speaking to, mostly from this prison cell, were Roman guards. And it says that Paul, his purpose and his mission was to come and preach the gospel. But the only people that he had at his disposal at this time were Roman guards. So he spoke to them. And later on, we see in the scripture that the believers in Philippi, that small group, grew so bold and courageous because of the news that Paul would go to prison for his beliefs, would sit in a jail cell for preaching Jesus. That's how much he believed it. These people had a new boldness come onto them, a new courage, and they preached the gospel like never before. And for me, understanding this whole scripture, I mean, it's good and well. And it makes sense, and it's heartwarming. But I think I've been in a prison cell, not literally, but figuratively. And there's been moments in my life where it feels like I have been trapped. And I think a lot of us can feel like that right now. And often our response is not to be joyful. It's not how our minds work. It's not our mindset. Until I read this other scripture in Philippians 1, and it's Philippians 1 verse 6, and it says, being confident of this, that he who began a good work in you will carry it on to completion until the day of Christ Jesus. This scripture blows my mind, because what it says is that the one who started the work in you is responsible to complete it, is responsible to finish it. Paul understood this in his heart. He wrote it down. He came to Philippi, or he came to that place to preach the gospel, to spread the good news. You'd think that being thrown into a prison cell would stop that. You'd think that he would sit there and be like, wow, when I had visioned the plan, the blueprint of me coming to preach the gospel was for me to go and speak to people, to stand in churches, to spread the news. Me being in a prison cell kind of gets in the way of that, kind of throws the plans and everything out of the window. But no, he is joyful. And I think it's because he understands something. He understands that, hey, the plan that God has for my life, my purpose is to preach the gospel. But my responsibility is not to complete the work that God has started in me. He'll complete it. So if I find myself in a prison today, I don't have to lose joy. I don't have to get upset. I don't have to moan or blame. I know that God is faithful to complete the work. And that's exactly what he did. The gospel was spread. Paul ministered to Roman guards. When would they ever have heard the gospel? And the believers that were still in Philippi managed to keep going with courage and with boldness. His purpose was fulfilled, even though he was in a place he never expected to be. This is what I want to ask us today. We all find ourselves in a place right now we never expected to be. But what work are you trying to complete that's actually God's responsibility to complete in your life? Because if we're in lockdown at the moment and you're sitting at home and you're stuck, or maybe you've taken a huge salary cut, or you've lost your job, or things are happening right now that you've never planned or never thought of, if you've got to come to a place now where you're saying, well, I've still got to complete the work, and you're not able to, that'll steal joy from your life. That'll rob joy from you, because right now everything has changed. All of our circumstances have changed. We can't do the things that we thought we were going to do in 2020. And that can take joy away from you. But this is why joy and suffering requires perspective. Because if you can understand, hey, it's not my responsibility to complete the work I feel God has called me to. It's not my responsibility to be the ultimate provision for my family and to trust God that we'll see through this, and to trust God with my kids' schooling, and to trust God that one day I'll go back to my business and it'll be just as strong. You don't have to be responsible for that, because God promises in chapter 1 verse 6 that he will complete the good work that he starts in you. So even if I find myself in a prison cell like the Apostle Paul, I can have joy. Even if I find myself trapped at home, not being able to go anywhere with worries and concerns, or even if I find myself with a salary cut, even if I find myself with my family worrying how we're going to make it through the next month, God promises to complete the work that he starts. So we can be joyful. We can rejoice. We can be glad in knowing that God will complete the work that he starts. I want to encourage you from wherever you're watching today. This is not your responsibility. There's a lot of concerns, and there's a lot of things that are taking joy from us at the moment. And I'm not saying they're valid. Of course they're valid. Of course you can be worried. Of course you can be concerned. But I'm saying suffering and joy in suffering comes on when we're able to understand that joy is an attitude. It's a choice, and it's a choice to trust in the promises of God. And Philippians 1 verse 6 is a promise. And that promise is that he who started the work is responsible to finish it. Look at your life right now. Look at the things that concern you. And you turn to God. You shift your perspective to God and say, God, you promised to finish this. I don't know what it's going to look like, I don't know when it's going to happen. I don't know when I'm going to go back to work. I don't know when we're going to see the end of this financially and make it out, but I trust you to do it. Joy in suffering requires a shift in perspective. It needs perspective. Today, church, I want you to turn the attention off of yourself. Let's put it on God, and let's trust God to do only the things that God can do. That's point number one. Joy in suffering requires perspective. My second point is this. Joy in suffering requires purpose in living. And my scripture is Philippians 1, verses 21 to 25. And it reads like this. For to me, to live is Christ, and to die is gain. If I'm going to go on living in the body, this will mean fruitful labor for me. Yet what shall I choose? I don't know. I'm torn between the two. I desire to depart and be with Christ, which is better by far, but it is more necessary for you that I remain in the body. Convinced of this, I know that I'll remain and I'll continue with all of you for the progress and the joy in the faith. What we find in the scripture, church, is that Paul finds himself in the middle of a tension. Remember, Paul, in chapter one and throughout this whole book, is in a prison cell. He's writing this letter. And the very real possibility that Paul could be executed is something that he's beginning to think about. The very real possibility that he could die. So he begins to have a thought. He says, well, you know what? Dying is probably the more favorable outcome for me. And if I had to think about that for a moment, I don't think he's saying that from a place of a suicidal thought. No, I think it's someone who has dedicated his purpose, dedicated his life, dedicated everything about what he does for God. So to be in God's presence, to die in that jail cell, would have been a win. It would have been a goal achieved. But then he has another thought. Then he thinks, but if I can stay here, whatever it looks like, whatever my circumstance looks like, whatever my life looks like, if I can stay, I can continue to fulfill the purpose that God has called me to do. I can continue to spread the gospel. I can continue to preach to the lost. I continue to go to lost cities and plant churches. So he said, for that reason, I'm going to stay. And the truth is, church, we need to understand something about purpose. If your joy is found in your circumstance, your joy will change with your circumstance. But if your joy is found in the purpose that God has called you to, your joy will never shift, because when you are in God, your purpose will never change. This is a question we need to ask ourselves today, church. What is our purpose? What is our calling? And if we look at Paul, we can see that his purpose was to preach the gospel and to build church. And I'm not saying that is everybody's purpose. I'm not saying that everybody's called to stand on a box and wave a Bible and to preach. If it's your calling, by all means, go for it. If not, maybe your calling is to be a teacher. Maybe your calling is to be a doctor or a dentist or a lawyer or anything along those lines. You have a calling. But the truth of the matter is, church, we can't base our lives on a calling that just revolves around providing for our physical needs, or just a calling that means I'm focused for my 9 to 5, but when I get home, everything is different. No, we need to have a calling. We need to have a purpose in our lives that can be seen through the lens of eternity, that can be seen through something that leaves a legacy. Because at the moment, a lot of people's callings and purposes that they think they have are being shook. People aren't able to work at the moment. Things are changing, so people are losing joy. But my purpose stays steadfast when it's seen through the lens of eternity. You're saying, Phil, well, what do you mean by that? Well, the scripture in 1 Corinthians 3, verse 12 to 13 explains it so well. It says that our work here on earth will one day be tested. The things that we can take with us to heaven, that will remain. The rest will be burnt up. And you can be saying, well, Phil, what can be taken to heaven? What will be burnt up? And the truth of the matter is, the one thing that can be taken to heaven is people. It's relationships. It's pointing people to Jesus. It's helping people realize that there is more to life than this. There is more to life than 70 years of working hard. There's more to life than 70 years of trying to do what you think will make you successful or popular or earn you the most money. There is more to life than that. I'm not saying at all that having nice things is a sin or a bad thing. I think it's great if you have an awesome car and a great house and go on awesome holidays. You can invite me the next time you go on one of these awesome holidays when we're allowed. I think it's amazing. What I do have a problem with is that if we revolve our joy, if our joy is dependent on something that we can't take with us to eternity, that we can't take with us when this life passes on, your joy will never be consistent. Your joy will never be full. Your joy will never be steadfast. It'll be something that comes and goes. It'll be something that we can't hold on to. And the truth is, church, like I said before, I'm saying people, that's the thing we can take with us to heaven. And I'm not saying that we all now need to become preachers and minister to people. I'm saying that in your current purpose, in your current circumstance, wherever you find yourself, you could be a student, you could be in high school, you could be a university scholar, you could be in the workplace. Wherever you find yourself, there is going to be an opportunity to turn your purpose into something eternal. There's going to be an opportunity to leave an eternal legacy by speaking to somebody about Jesus, by speaking to somebody about the Word of God, by bringing something eternal into the conversation. It doesn't mean leave your job. You've worked hard for your job. You've got a great job. That's not what I'm saying. I'm saying that there is a moment where you can take things and you can give it eternal value, where you can give it purpose, because joy needs to be found in purpose. It can't be found in circumstance. It can't be found in what life looks like in front of me. When you find your purpose, when you find what God has called you to, you will wake up happy. I mean, I'm doing the Alpha course at the moment, and I love the description that Nikki Gumbel shares. He just says before he was a Christian, before he was saved, he actually said that Christians used to freak him out because they were just smiling all the time, and it was spooky. And when I thought about that, I thought, you know, that's hilarious. I had the same kind of picture and idea about Christians before I became one. But the truth is, when you do become a Christian and you do find the purpose and the calling God has for your life, you do wake up happy every day. You do wake up with joy, regardless of your circumstance, because your joy doesn't shift. Joy in suffering requires purpose in living. We need to find that, church. We need to find that purpose. And the chances are that you're already in your purpose. You're already in your calling. You're living it out. But we need to add things of eternal value into that purpose, because that's where we'll find joy. And you might be saying, Phil, maybe I'm not doing what God has called me to do. Maybe you felt called from God to do something different, to go along another line. Don't be scared about what people say, about what the world defines as success, or what people say about you. When you follow the purpose of God, you live a life of eternal value. You live a life of eternal significance, and you can make an impact for the kingdom of God. And that's what we want for our church. We want to have joy in suffering, but that requires purpose in living. I hope this is helping somebody today. My last point is this: joy in suffering, it requires understanding. And the scripture that I'll be reading is Philippians 1, verses 28 to 29. And it says this: don't be intimidated in any way by your enemies. This will be a sign to them that they are going to be destroyed, but that you are going to be saved, even by God himself. For you have been given not only the privilege of trusting in Christ, but also the privilege of suffering for him. And again, this is one of those scriptures where you're like, Phil, I don't know, that's hard to understand. That's hard to do. I can understand the privilege of trusting in Christ, but the privilege of suffering for him, you know, is he worth suffering for? Is my life worth going through moments of suffering, going through pain, going through trials? So I want to take some time in this point as we wrap up and just speak a bit about suffering. Speak a bit about what it means, because we've taken time to speak about joy and joy in suffering. But what does suffering look like for us today? What does it mean, and why does it happen? Why does God allow things to happen in our lives? And I hope this helps somebody. My first point under point number three is this: suffering is multifaceted. It's important to understand that suffering can happen in different areas in your life. The scripture here is 2 Corinthians 4 verse 8 to 9. And it says, we are hard pressed on every side, but not crushed. We are perplexed, but not in despair. We're persecuted, but not abandoned. We're struck down, but not destroyed. Just from this verse, we can see that there's suffering in different areas of our life: emotional, physical, spiritual, even mentally. And you might be saying, Phil, you know, that's not very encouraging that I can encounter suffering in all those different ways. What I want to encourage you with today is that we have got a God that wants to bring complete maturity. He wants to bring growth. He wants to bring healing in all the areas of your life. And sometimes, and we would have experienced this for ourselves, sometimes going through something difficult provides the very avenue that you need to grow and become mature and to become complete. It's not good enough to be physically mature, but emotionally immature. It's not good enough to be spiritually mature, but mentally you're immature. God wants to bring complete fullness and wholeness to your life. And suffering and trials are often the thing that he uses. And point number two explains why. Point number two is this: suffering equips us for ministry. It says in Corinthians 2 verse 1 to 4, he who comforts us in all our troubles so that we can comfort those in any trouble with the comfort that we ourselves receive from God. And what the scripture is basically saying, that sometimes trials and suffering in your life become the ultimate qualifier for you to help somebody else suffering in theirs. An example would be, even growing up in my life, as a teenager and as a young adult, there were things that I went through that in the moment I really had to question God. I really had to doubt God. And if you've ever had moments where you've doubted God, that's okay. You know, that's not a sin. But I doubted God, I questioned him, I questioned why these things were happening to me, what I had done wrong to go through it. And hey, I'm only 24 now, and I'm still figuring things out. I'm still trying to understand the purpose and the calling God has for me. But one of the first things that I noticed when I became a youth pastor and I started chatting to young people, I started chatting to teenagers, a lot of the time, teenagers would come to me and they would express something that's happening in their life, and the very same thing happened to me. I come from a family of divorce. I made some bad decisions growing up that left me in some bad situations. I struggled with some mental issues growing up as well. And I found it so funny. There would be children, there would be teenagers that would come up to me and say, Phil, this is what I'm going through. This is what I'm experiencing. And for me personally, I could look to them in the eyes and honestly and authentically say, it's going to get better. God will use this. God will turn this around, and I'm a stronger, more complete Christian for it. Not because my life was perfect, not because it was void of trial. No, the fact that there was trial in my life, the fact that there was suffering, the fact that I had to go through some stuff and get to the other side, I've been able to see the goodness of God through it. I can see God giving me a life that I've always wanted, a purpose that I've always yearned for. Just because it's perfect doesn't mean that it's the right thing from God. And this is something that we believe from the world. We think that as soon as something bad happens, it can't be from God. No, God wouldn't do that. God wouldn't bring a bad trial into my life. No, God will use what he needs to use to bring you to a place of maturity and fullness and growth. And sometimes we need to work through some trials. Sometimes we need to work through some growth issues. Sometimes we need to move through some obstacles and circumstances to become the people that God has called us to be. Don't run away from a trial. Don't run away from an obstacle. We as believers, we don't have a mild, temperate spirit. No, we are fighters. We are overcomers. We are conquerors. When something comes into our life that we struggle with or that we find is hindering us, we go straight through it because we have got the power of God living inside of us. The same power that resurrected Jesus Christ from the cross lives inside of me. The lockdown is not going to hold me back. Me losing my job or taking a salary cut is not going to hold me back. God is the one who started it. He's going to be the one to complete it. And he is going to do something inside of me that when I look back in 5 years' time, I can say, hey, it was tough. Hey, I struggled, but I'm so glad I stayed faithful. I'm so glad I stayed trusting God because he has molded me into a better man today. It's not about becoming perfect. No one is perfect. We all get it wrong all the time. Even me, even Swin, we get it wrong all the time. The truth is not about becoming perfect, but it's becoming about more like God. It's growing in obedience. It's growing in availability. And God will often use suffering. He'll use trials. He'll use obstacles to draw us closer to him. And in that, we see the goodness of God and we hold on to our joy. My last point here, three, is that suffering is a battleground. And we need to understand that whenever we go through suffering, that a battle is taking place. And like I've just mentioned, the battle is between good and evil. Good says that whatever you're going through right now, I'm using it and I'm turning it for your good. I'm using it to build something inside of you. I'm using it to build something through you. Evil says that, hey, if it's bad, it can't be from God. If it's bad, it means turn on the government, turn on people, blame, point fingers, this isn't how it should be, this isn't right, and you need to make a decision, church, on which side you're going to fight for. Am I going to fight for the good side? Am I going to trust God that through the pain, that through the trials, through the obstacles, that I'm going to stay faithful, that I'm going to stay trusting, that when the time comes when I make my way through it, because you need to understand this about Christianity, about faith. Becoming a Christian is not about suffering for 60 or 70 years. No, there's great times that we experience as Christians. There's amazing times we experience God's goodness and His faithfulness so often as believers. But there'll be times of suffering. There'll be times of trial. And we need to understand, hey, am I gonna trust God in this? Am I gonna have faith during this trial that God is doing something special inside of me that's growing me, developing me? Or are we gonna take the side of evil and say, no, we're not happy with this. This is not how it was meant to be. This is not how the plan was supposed to lay out. To be honest, church, I'm so grateful for a God that doesn't follow my plans. I'm so grateful for a God that knows way more than I do. A scripture in Isaiah that encourages me so frequently is that His ways are not my ways. His thoughts are not my thoughts. The fact that 2020 has brought a pandemic, that has brought a global lockdown, that's scary, but it's quite an awesome reminder that we serve a God that is so in control. We serve a God that is so big that even when things are literally coming to a standstill on earth, we've got a God who's still good. We've got a God that is still using all of this. I want to close off with a scripture in James verses 1, 2 to 4. It says, consider it pure joy, my brothers and sisters, whenever you face trials of many kinds, because you know that the testing of your faith produces perseverance. Let perseverance finish its work so that you may be mature and complete, not lacking anything. I don't know about you, church, but I don't want to lack anything as a believer. I want to live a life of significance. We say it sometimes in church, but when I wake up in the morning, I want the devil to be a little scared that fills up. I want him to be a little frightened that I might do some damage to the kingdom of darkness and do some good for the kingdom of light. But the truth is, if I want to be a person of significance, I need to understand that God might take me through some things. He might take me through some trials, through some struggles, so that I can become that person, lacking nothing, growing in perseverance. Someone who says, you can throw what you need to throw at me, Satan. You can bring whatever you need to bring my way, but I'm going to overcome it. And I believe we've got a church of people like that. I believe you at home watching have the ability to be that type of person. You wake up in the morning and you are a force for the kingdom of God. You are a force for Jesus to use, a vessel to move the kingdom of God forward in whatever context you find yourself in. But we need to understand that, hey, we need to be people of joy. You know, we can't go through life just because our circumstance looks different, just because we're facing obstacles, that joy isn't with us, that we can't have joy because our life doesn't look like someone or doesn't look like something that produces happiness. No, our joy is not in our circumstance. We know that our God has given us the victory. We know that one day we'll spend eternity in heaven, and God's promises are yes and amen. And those promises apply to me and they apply to you. So yes, sometimes can get hairy on earth, but I can stay joyful. I can stay smiling. I can stay content because I've got a God who's called all things to work together for the good of those called according to His purpose. So I want to ask a question now, and this is for everybody sitting at home. I don't know where you find yourself. You might be saying, Phil, you know what? This lockdown has really done a number on me. I haven't had joy for a while. I feel distant from God. I feel even distant from my family. I need to come close to God. I need to get that joy again. And you might be saying, Phil, I don't even remember what it's like to be joyful. I've had so much anxiety, so much depression, so much to deal with. I don't even remember what it's like to be joyful. I want to say to you, and I want to give you some encouraging news, that when we invite Jesus into our heart, you invite joy into your heart. You invite peace. You invite life. You invite love. So I want to give some people an opportunity today. And this is going to be nothing weird, nothing strange. If you are on our church online platform, even YouTube and Facebook, I want to give you an opportunity this morning to choose Jesus, to choose God. The truth of the matter is that we all come to a crossroad, a moment in our life where we choose God, where we choose good, or where we make another decision. And today you have got an opportunity to make that choice. I'm going to ask you to put pride down. Hey, there's nobody watching you. You're in your home. But I want to say just for a moment, put pride down. Look at your life. Inspect your life. And try to understand that God is calling you. It says in His word that He stands at the door and knocks. He doesn't push His way in. He waits for us to welcome Him in. So if it's fine with you, I'd love to just say a prayer for all those people that are saying, Phil, that's me. I want to choose Jesus today. I want to hand my life over to Him. I want to experience this joy. Even when my circumstance says different, I want to experience this joy that God has for me. Well, let's bow our heads and pray. Father God, we thank You that no matter how far we run, no matter how distant we feel, God, that you are always one decision away. God, I want to pray for the people that are making a decision for you today. God, I thank you, Lord. It says in your word that there is a great celebration in heaven when people turn back to God, when they make a decision for you, Lord, that the angels erupt with praise. And God, we celebrate the exact same way right now. God, if there's people right now, Lord, that are saying, hey, that's me, I want to make a decision for Jesus. God, I pray specifically for those people. God, I pray that you can bless them. I pray that you can shower favor on them, blessing on them. God, I pray that they can experience your anointing in everything that they do. God, let their life change. Let it never be the same. And let them experience your presence like never, ever before. And all God's people said, amen, amen, amen. Well, church, this is an amazing, amazing day. Even if there has just been one person today that has made a choice for Jesus, that's an eternity changed forever. So if that's you, I'm going to encourage you to be bold. Be courageous. If you're on church online, there should be a tab that pops up soon that says, I've made a decision or I've made a commitment. I want you to click yes. I want you to click that's me. I want you to boldly declare that God has changed your life this morning. And I promise you, you're going to see his hand move. If you're on YouTube or on Facebook, same for you. Even if you need to write in the comments, God changed my life today. I made a decision for Jesus today. I'm going to encourage you to do it. Let's stand up in boldness today and trust God to do what only he can do. Well, we've come to the end of our message, and really it's been a great honor and privilege for me to be with you today. Please don't leave any of our platforms without connecting with us. For some of you, you need to take a step. You need to take a next step in our church. And I don't know where you're all at. You could be first-time visitors. And if you are here for the first time, welcome. I trust that you've had an amazing Sunday. But I think some people here need to join a life group. And I want to direct you, if you're on church online, fill in a connection card. Jump onto that link. Say, hey, that's me. I want to join a life group. I want to be a part of community. Now is the perfect time. I'm telling you, the enemy just wants to isolate. He wants to pull you apart. But when you put yourself in great company with people who love you and who you love, you can go to a new level every single week. So join a life group. I know there's some people here that need to jump on the growth track, fill in a connection card, connect with us, let us know. And lastly, if you've got any prayer requests or praise reports, God is doing something amazing in your life, we want to celebrate with you. We want to be a part of that. And if you've got any prayer requests you need in God to come through for you in a way, please use a connection card, fill that out to us. We pray over our cards every single week. And we love that we get to do that. We love that we get to pray. Well, church, this has been an amazing Sunday. We trust that you've had a great week one of the joy I wish I had, joy in suffering. We can't wait to see you next week. God bless you. Have a great one.